Welcome. This is Visible Lady of Faith.
And Pastor Scott.
Coming to you with Spiritual Perspectives of the Sunday School Lesson entitled...
As you're sitting and reading everything, process it.
Jesus Reinstates Peter for Sunday, April the 23rd, 2023.
Yes, well, you got it. You know, you said you want to connect it to today where people can relate to it. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, when we say spiritual food, well, spiritual food comes in yes, the gospel. But when you go into the Old Testament...
Well, what do you mean by the gospel? Because some people might not understand what the gospel is.
The death, the burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ, the gospel. When Jesus was here from 30 to 33 years old, mm-hmm. that the word and the teaching there, that's the gospel. What they were taught and the death and the burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ, that is what's being taught. But see... I like what my dad, when he was preaching, he says, you know, when you're going out making fisher of men, yeah, you're bringing them in, but after you bring them in, now you got to clean up the fish and prepare them, et cetera. In other words, what I'm saying, they come into church, yes, their name's on the church roll, they joined the church. Now what do you do with them? And I mean, today, they got marriage couples, they got family therapy, you know, and some just talking about business. In other words, they're building the characteristics of each individual mm-hmm. sheep. When you say feed your sheep, you're not just sitting there feeding the sheep. You got to mm-hmm. protect them. Mm-hmm. Protect them from the wolves and everything else. Mm-hmm. And us as black folks, we're not given the tools and everything to get homes, to run a business, or to, mm-hmm. you know, to continue to get your children educated. Because anyway, all I'm saying, we have to be... have to want to give our sheep, as pastors, our sheep, the best chance for survival.
Not just as pastors, I believe as believers, because I think as believers we are all responsible for doing what is right and for setting a good example and try not to set put a stumbling block in someone's way. And true. I know we're not perfect. We're not saying we're perfect, but at least we have the desire to continue to try.
Yeah, but see, but what I'm saying, I hear what you're saying, mm-hmm. but but what I'm getting at, that is not just on the pastor, he's one person.
It's not just on the pastor, it's all of us.
Yes, you just said that, yes. And I'm saying, yeah. But I'm trying to get related to today. Okay. If there's a lawyer in the congregation, you know, they should... You know, you shouldn't take your lawyer hat and say, I'm going to get my spiritual food. No, part of that spiritual food, once you get it, then you got to go to work with it.
Right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you're an accountant or you're a computer person or you're working for the city or something, mm-hmm. however you what you've learned, you should come back and share it with the flock, you know, with the flock that you're in. Because it's not just because you remember when Jesus, when he was doing the taking care of the sick, the healing, the miracles, and what have you, those tools were given to those 12, mm-hmm. okay, to his original 12 disciples. They also continued with this. They didn't just share the word of God. They also helped with the physical part of that sheep, too. That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that when you were talking about the ministers, talking about, like if you have a lawyer in your congregation, or you have an accountant, or you have a school teacher, you have different ministries. Handy. Some churches do have different ministries, like couples, financial, you know, awareness,
mental health, anything,
mental health. Mental health. So I think those are relevant ministries that churches should have
to help
the congregation. The flock. Yeah. Sheep is symbolic for us believers. Right? And so the disciples were tasked with continuing Jesus' ministry. They were the only ones that could, like, heal people. I mean, they can give them the word, but what about healing and providing food or counsel to them?
If you notice that was given to them, because you got to remember, this is a movement that needed to get started, that God wanted to get started. Mm-hmm. And you had to come out with a punch. You know, when you see the miracles and everything, that grass and bought in a lot of people. Now, people wish they could see the miracles today.
Right.
But guess what? We can see those miracles. If we can provide those miracles to people, by simply when you see a homeless person or you see somebody in need, you know, reach out to them.
Yeah. I'm kind of a failure in that area because I see a lot of homeless people and I don't always reach out to them.
Well,
you know, because it's like we talk about it, but when are we going to start doing it?
Okay.
You know,
that's why we need to sit and read, because, you know, there was a time Jesus, you know, when the woman that issued blood that touched the hem of his garment and he felt it, because Jesus had energy. And when he touched it, it sucked the life out of him. Even when he prayed a long time, you know, when the disciples fell asleep.
What do you mean sucked the life out of him?
Okay, he felt his virtue and everything came out of him when the woman touched. He said, "Who touched me?"
Mm-hmm.
He felt that came out of, just like he's saying, trying to get motivated.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people can say to me, and boy, just the energy just gone.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
Some people just complain a lot, and it just drains your energy.
Right.
So that's what I'm talking about. Jesus, he got tired. He was in the flesh form. This is my point. You see enough homeless people, it drains your energy. You got to go away and pray to get back up again.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have you're not at 100%. Like our cell phones, everything we have, it drains. You got to recharge it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you're expecting yourself to be available all the time, that is a trick of the mind of Satan. And then you're going to have yourself, oh, wow, I failed. No, you didn't fail. You got some of the job done. It takes a lot of people.
Yeah, it takes a lot of people.
Because look how this country was built on the back of slaves.
And a lot of money to fix the problem.
And
I believe there's enough money in the world to fix the homeless issue.
You people are trying to control people through fear,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to putting a team together, as opposed to, you know, being loving and nurturing and helping one another.
Mm-hmm.
That's, they just want to keep our focus on what God wants to do it, not the way Satan and man wants to do it.
Yeah, and I think a lot of issues that we have is because the priority of people is not, you know, it's not to be compassionate, it's not to be caring. Well, some people are, but it's like people, I heard somebody mention this, you know, you want all this money just to buy what? A bigger house? What? Another pair of shoes? Or what? More clothes? You know, that's just like material stuff. And people are like starving.
Mike didn't say anything, but just process it. If you notice, the wife and I, sometimes we are passionate about what we're saying, but we realize that when we're talking, you got to talk, you got to listen, but we're missing the piece inside it to get to communicate. Is you got to understand. That's what it means, process. You got to understand what the other person is saying.
Right. You have to understand.
Because myself personally, I get frustrated at times because I don't think she's listening to me yet sometimes. So, so I told her, you know, you got a thought, but come on, you got to either write it down or something so the other person, we got to be fair to one another is all I'm trying to say.
Last Sunday's lesson was Jesus cooks breakfast. So that we thought that was an interesting lesson, especially the part where it said when they brought the boat, that Jesus had already started the grill and was cooking fish. And we were wondering if it was part of the fish that the disciples caught or was it different?
He already had fish.
Fish. He already had fish.
You got to remember.
So we thought that point was interesting. That was in the lesson.
Yeah, but see, the fish, you got to remember, he told him to put the net on the other side of the boat.
Right.
So yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. Jesus said, let me go fishing. Hey, you, get on the grill. And they go, okay. And walk and jump on the grill. So that, you know, people said, it's not happening. You know, they rather go say, well, how did he do that? Yes, it is a good question. How he did it, but. Neither here nor there.
Right.
He had fish on the grill.
Right.
But it was
that's the point.
It was not the fish
that ate. They were able to eat.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because that was already, breakfast was already going. So,
and
they were coming up with all this fish in the net. So breakfast was already going.
Right. Okay. So this lesson, Jesus Reinstates Peter, is a continuation of, in fact, the last three or four lessons have been about, you know, after Jesus was resurrected, he appeared to different people. He wanted to prove that the prophecy of him coming back from the dead was true. And so he made sure that he saw his disciples
and other people. Keep his word.
Yeah, keep his word, right. And I think that's a good point that we can learn from in our lives. If we say we're going to do something, we need to keep our word and do it. Now, if we can't do it, let whoever we told that we were going to do it, let them know that, oh, I'm not able to do it this time, or I'm not able to go, you know, this place this time.
Well, Jesus would have had no integrity at all with the disciples, and we would not be sitting here talking about the word of God if Jesus didn't come back and say, okay, because he told the disciples, I'm going to rise. And people say, okay, whatever that means.
They hadn't processed it.
Yeah.
They didn't quite understand what he was talking about.
Because I don't expect my dad to come back from the dead or any of our loved ones coming back from the dead. But physically, someone come back from the dead, you're going to make a believer out of me. But you're going to take a while to convince me that you did come back from the dead. Mm-hmm.
And this is what Jesus was doing. He was going around convincing people and proving that he had, you know.
He had risen.
Risen, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think that was well said. You said it well that time.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. So another point I thought was interesting was about when Jesus asked Peter three times, do you love me?
Yeah.
It's like, so we were talking about this the other night, and we came to the conclusion that this was like before Jesus was crucified, Peter had denied Christ three times.
That's correct.
Right? Three times. So I don't think that scenario was ever concluded. So this, after he risen, rose, this is how that event was concluded. So Jesus wanted to know if Peter loved him because he had denied him three times. And I think he wanted to, some people may have thought Jesus was insecure about asking him. Or even
Jesus was insecure?
Yeah, that's what I'm just speculating about. Nah. Why did he have to ask him so many times? He knows, Father knows everything.
Okay, first of all, the creator of the universe and everything that knows all.
Right.
Okay, and he called Peter the rock.
Okay.
Okay, and if you look at, you know, because I wonder why did you go to sleep in the class? So I was one that sat in the class. As a matter of fact, a friend of mine called me, they call you a square or a nerd, they call them today.
What class are you talking about?
When I was back in high school, I ran into some friends there. We were talking about how we grew up as kids, you know, as men now today.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, they call you square. In other words, like a nerd.
Right, right.
Okay. So, but the interesting part about it is a rock. How's a rock form? Over time, you just get layers and pressure and everything, and it becomes harder and harder.
Layers of what?
Layers of dirt, sediment. You know, the stuff that goes around a rock, you know, that forms a rock, it just gets mm-hmm. harder over time.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you got a little bitty rock, just like in plumbing, those that have done plumbing, you know, stuff in the old galvanized pipe, the little crud and rust in there gets harder and harder mm-hmm. over mm-hmm. time.
Yeah.
So, in other words, you have a small little grain, and over time you get more in layers and layers and layers, and it mm-hmm. gets bigger and bigger right. as a rock, and it gets harder, mm-hmm. you know, over time.
Right.
They were hung and all kinds of stuff that was, you know, being done to them because they're spreading the gospel.
But I think spiritual strength or integrity is an ongoing process. Just because we accept, I don't think it's going to happen overnight. Just like you were talking about our relationship, yep. it was soft and then it got hard and then it got solid. Being a believer and, you know, showing, you know, that integrity and that confidence and that security and that faith is just an ongoing process. It's just not going to happen overnight. Yeah. It's an ongoing process, but we have to make up in our mind that this is something we want and something we're going to continue to work on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you know,
it's a relationship. We work on our relationships.
Life experience. Stop allowing people to demonize, you know, things. Some processes are, you're not going to get it right. You're going to fail, but you get. As long as you're alive, you got a chance to keep working. Right. You know, working on whatever it takes to do.
I just thought about like. Grief. Grief doesn't, you don't get rid of grief overnight. It's
nope.
an ongoing process for different people.
Yep.
So our life as a believer is an ongoing process. There's no certain time where we say, oh, I got this right. I'm perfect now. We'll never get there. We'll just keep trying to do right and to show love for the rest of our lives.
And see, like for instance now, just to give you a case in point, just think about this. Let's just say we all win the lottery, and I'll put something like $5 million, okay?
Ooh.
Everybody's saying woo. Now, the question is, Will it change you as a person? How solid are you in your faith? How solid are you, with anything? Because if it turns around and you don't know how to manage that $5 million, that $5 million may lead you into a lot of regret. You may be doing things that you shouldn't have. Because some people think $5 million is a lot of money. It's not a lot of money. Because you give me $5 million, I'd like to do it, I'll put it in investments so that $5 million and go to work and make some more money. But see, other people say, no, let me go buy a car, which depreciates. Let me go buy this here, take everybody out and spend. We're going to go on a cruise and probably spend like $30,000 on this and $40,000. When you keep doing this all over the place, I say within 5 years, you'll be broke where you started from the beginning and don't have anything. You have a lot of creditors coming at you. So, matter of fact, to make a long story short, they did a survey on people that won the lottery. They said it's now on the average. The people didn't know what they were doing. In 5 years, they were broke. Mm-hmm. That's where I got that number from.
Relationships, and I don't know, just people see things differently. This is something that I got from the lesson. And these people hold on to these abusive, these physical or emotional abusive relationships because maybe they are insecure, or they don't want to be lonely, and they have the desire to feel loved and supported. So this is why I think some people do that in their relationships.
I see.
Looking for love, because I think my mother is a good example of that, because her background. I think she was looking for love. That's why she had three children, and we all had, as they say now, three different baby daddies. So we were a product of that, and it's just, it's interesting what people will do. Maybe they're aware, maybe they're not aware of what they're doing and why they're doing it.
But see, basically what you're saying, people should stop and understand the cultures of who they're talking to. And people seem to, I have this whole phrase where they say, people ask the question, give an answer, and then they said that person told them, and it's not true. Because we need to sit and take the time to process and get to know each other. Like right now, today, it's just crazy things that are going on in the world. And basically what we have to do is stop making the assumption everybody had the same experience as yourself. Mm-hmm. So you have to listen to the other person.
Right.
I'm happy that my wife she has the courage to share that with you, because it's important that you understand that.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the wife and I, we were raised totally different.
Right.
And people say, oh, I don't want to be in that relationship because we're incompatible. Mm-hmm. I'm here to tell you that this is how love works. When you really put the truth, that when they say God is love, you put true love into action, you'll see the world totally different. Because I can sit here and say, her point of view, I can demonize her and do all kinds of things. But that's not going to really work. Because then you're going to feel like a fool when you find out that person saw it differently. And it's not just because, I put it this way, just because she doesn't see it the way I see it, she is trying to understand her relationship with God just like I am trying to. So
understand your relationship with God.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's just like everybody. If you spend more time trying to love and understand one another, and it's not all always about sex and how much money, if you're into that kind of stuff, as soon as that runs out, you're done with the person. So you're not really married to the person. You're married to whatever in the world, or a relationship, whatever you can get it to benefit yourself. That sounds selfish to me. So, this is the whole thing that Jesus, here he was showing the love. He was cooking breakfast last time for it, because he loved his disciples.
Mm-hmm.
And he was, now he's having
to serve them.
And
yeah,
he's talking to the disciples this time, mm-hmm, making sure they understood that, yes, time, I want to make sure you see me, you touch me. Now, feed my sheep. Feed the word of God. Spread the word.
Forever, yep. So this is what I want you to do.
Yep, that's it.
Okay, so one thing also that I learned from this interaction with Peter and Jesus was that love is forgiving. So we don't know how Peter was feeling before Jesus. We know how he felt after he denied Jesus, but we don't know how he was feeling after the resurrection, and he was, you know, they're having this interaction about, you know, Jesus asking him, do you love me, you know. So I think Peter wanted to be sure that Jesus forgave him and that they were still friends and that he wasn't holding a grudge about that previous situation that happened, that denial situation that happened before Jesus was crucified. So, There was something else I wanted to mention, and I tried to find some information on it, but I really didn't find that when Jesus said to Peter, feed my sheep. So we know that sheep represents believers. And we know that the characteristics of a sheep is that they're like gentle animal, and they're humble, and they're peaceful. So this was, I believe, symbolic for what we as believers should be. We should have those same characteristics.
Okay, are you back to this question? What Jesus meant when feed my sheep, take care of my sheep.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, feed the word of God. Feed what I want them to hear, the gospel. In other words, if you go back in the Old Testament, all the things that a Christ-like person or a Christian or person to behave, in other words, feed them and train them to do it. The same thing with our kids. We didn't train them to be killers and robbers and liars and what have you. We trained them to be, good people, you know, have a morals and thing. Basically, that's what you're feeding them. They're feeding the good stuff, you know, behaving. Mm-hmm. When you're feeding, it's not just giving them food. You know, Peter was an example. You know, he did what Jesus did, you know, the healing, you know, going, you know, the healing, the touching, the preaching, and going and encouraging people to do the right thing, mm-hmm. if you want to put it in today's term. That's what you're feeding. You're feeding them good morals.
Okay. Another thing I wanted to, in fact, I just heard this today, which I agree with it. Okay, feeding is not just words, but we have to, like this person was talking about our children, how we tell them, you know, clean your room, watch this, do this, do that. But we know that they watch us. I think what we do, our actions have more weight than our words. So as believers, we have to make sure that the words are good, but our actions are even
better.
So make sure that we're doing what we talk about, what we believe, and then I think that would have a greater impact on people versus just telling them the words and just, you know, our actions. Our actions are just as important, or more important.
Because our children, are like empty vessels. Now, what are you going to put into them?
Right.
So they're watching. They're going to watch your behavior more than what your words are.
Right.
And when we're not talking about this, you know, when you say feed my sheep, is, you know, like I grew up on. Well, okay, when the preacher's preaching at you, like I said, most of the time I remember as a kid, I went to sleep. So how in the world am I getting fed by those words? But when I look at the men in the church when I was a small kid, if they're saying one thing in the church and they're doing something outside of the church, guess which one is going to sink in? What they did out of the church.
Actions, yeah,
and that's what they're feeding me. They're feeding me their deceit, you know, what's going on. Mm-hmm. So I don't care what anybody says. Just because you get up and use a few words, I'm still watching what's going on. Because look at the chaos that's going on in our politics and everything. Mm-hmm. You know, just those are good examples.
I think that goes back to what I said earlier about priorities. The people aren't their priority, even though they're supposed to be our representatives. Their priorities are not where they should be, or where I think they should be, or where the people think they should be. You know, serving the people.
Well, look at this. When you say back to saying feeding my sheep, well, look what's being fed with the politicians, because you know people. Are coming out mimicking what they're seeing in the news. They're trying to say, well, I can turn around and do this here. It's okay. So, it's just a lot of crazy stuff. I mean, you hear enough news, it's depressing to listen to it. But also at the same time, those are very good examples. That's not what I want to feed the community. is mm-hmm. corruption and lying and what have you. And people are taking that on and say, oh, I can get away with it. I can make money. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and you know, it's good for in the moment. Mm-hmm. But as time goes on, you can see, because as we're looking at the news, you're going to see all these people say, how come God is allowing them to get away with it? Eventually, it's going to catch up with them. And when they say vengeance is mine, says the Lord, that's what it means. They're going to come to justice in time, not our time. You know, one time where we want them to, but they're eventually going to get there. Mm-hmm. Just keep living. Because mm-hmm. when I can say by my age, you know, I'm in my 70s right now, and guess what? I'm seeing it. Just be patient. It's coming. Because everybody that think they're getting away with stuff, oh, they're not. And I ain't talking about when they meet God. Because eventually, we'll put it this way and make it simple. Because when, you know, whenever I got a traffic ticket or something like that, and I've been just breaking the law, speeding and doing everything, and I finally get caught. And when I get caught, it's not at the time that I want to do it, because it may be at a time where the ticket is like $3,000 or $4,000 or $5,000 or $6,000, and I don't have the money. It's not the right time. It should have came when I won the lottery last week. Then I could have paid it. It's not when I want to, because God's trying to get our attention. Mm-hmm. He's always going to do it when it's not convenient for oneself.
Right. Okay, so thank you for watching this video, and I hope you
be encouraged
and motivated by our discussion of the Sunday school lesson. Try to apply it, you know, related to like everyday life. And please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share our video. And we'll see you next time.